الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. ومعه الحمد لله. إن شاء الله we are continuing our study of the سيرة of the Prophet محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. May Allah سبحانه وتعالى increase us all in knowledge as He سبحانه وتعالى commanded the Prophet محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم saying وَقُلْ رَبِّي زِدِنِي عِلْمًا. So we all make the same dua, رَبِّي زِدِنِي عِلْمًا. And as you know that Prophet Muhammad sallam was not asked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to call upon Allah to increase him of anything other than ilm. This is the only thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded Prophet Muhammad sallam to ask Allah to increase him of this knowledge. So alhamdulillah, knowledge is light and is guidance, and also inshallah beneficial knowledge. When we seek it, then inshallah we are rewarded by the grace and favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is not it's a very special branch of knowledge, because this is the knowledge about our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept this inshallah and bestow us all the shafa'a of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So now last time we have already spoken about the dangers that were awaiting the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Muslims after the Battle of Badr. And we have come to know that one of these dangers came from the side of some of the Jewish people who used to live in Al-Madinah. Because when they saw the manifest victory that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to Muslims, and when they perceived the awesome presence of Muslims in Al-Madinah, many of them were not able even to conceal their resentment against the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and against Muslims. And the most wicked group of them was called Banu Qaynuqa. And they used to live in quarters inside Al-Madinah, which was named after them. That was called quarters of Bani Qaynuqa, as a tribe of Qaynuqa. And they used to take up jobs like goldsmithing and blacksmithing, and also they used to work in some crafts of making household instruments. And because of this, they used to have many weapons inside even their homes, and they were the most brave party of the Jewish people who lived in Al-Madinah at that time. And they were about 700 warriors who were very well experienced in war. And they were the first to breach the covenant that Prophet Muhammad sallam made with the Jewish people of Al-Madinah, and that was calling to cooperation and non-aggression. So after the Battle of Badr, they couldn't conceal their hatred against Muslims, and they started a process of troublemaking and jeering at Muslims, hurting Muslims whenever Muslims would go to their bazaars, because they used to have bazaars selling different goods. And even they started frightening Muslim ladies, the sahabiyat, the female companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what did the Prophet Muhammad sallam do? And we have to pay attention to this, because some people accuse Muslims that they go straightforward to fighting or they start aggression. But this is completely the opposite, totally the opposite. Because those people, they started aggression against Muslims. And when they started their aggression against Muslims, The first thing that the Prophet Muhammad Sallam did was not that he even gave them back their bad treatment, but he just went to them and he started calling them, you know, to have good relations with Muslims, and you know, and also he warned them about the bad consequences of continuing doing so. But unfortunately, they didn't listen. So Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, the first thing he did, though they started aggression against Muslims, he didn't allow even Muslims to, you know, to do any harmful thing against them, those Jewish people of Banu Qaynuqa in Medina. But the Prophet himself spoke to them, to Bani Qaynuqa, and he called them, you know, just, you know, to have good relation with Muslims and to stay together in Al-Madinah peacefully, as they have already agreed when Prophet Muhammad ﷺ before concluded the this covenant with them upon his entry to Al-Madinah. But they again, they refused to listen to the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, and they continued continued their aggression and bad treatment to Muslims, and like frightening Muslims ladies, as we will come to know now, and helping Muslims when they used to come to their brothers to buy any goods and so on, and laughing at Muslims and you know, causing many other troubles for Muslims. So it was narrated in the book of Abu Dawood, this is one of the books of the Sunnah, on the authority of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma. لما أصاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قريشا يوم بدر وقدم المدينة جمع اليهود في سوق بني قينقاع. When Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, after Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم had defeated Quraysh on the day of Badr, and after he had come back to Al-Madinah, and then the Jewish people of Banu Qaynuqa started their aggression against Muslims, Prophet Muhammad called those people of Banu Qaynuqa, you know, to gather, and he started to speak to them. فَقَالَ يَا مَعْشَرَ يَهُودْ أَسْلِمُ قبل أن يصيبكم مثل ما أصاب قريشا. He said to them, O people of Yahud, submit to the truth, submit to the, you know, rules of justice, and you know, do this before you may suffer, you have the same suffering that the Quraysh had. So Prophet Muhammad said aslimu, but you know, the interpreters of the seerah, they said this word aslimu didn't mean that be Muslims, but it meant like aslimu, you know, so submission to the truth, you know, and to the law of the Lord who has created this universe, that people should not you know, be enemies to each other, they should you know, have peaceful treatments with each other and so on. So aslimu means, you know, like surrender to the truth and surrender to the standard of good morals, you know, and so on. But they replied saying, يَا مُحَمَّدْ لَا يَغُرَّنَّكَ مِنْ نَفْسِكَ أَنَّكَ قَتَلْتَ نَفَرًا مِنْ قُرَيْشٍ وَكَانُوا أَغْمَارًا. O Muhammad, don't deceive yourself just because you have defeated some people from Quraysh, and they were inexperienced in war. And of course, this is a lie, and this is also, you know, a bad answer, which showed that they had a strong will to, you know, to take Muslims as their enemies, you know, to confront Muslims, to do something against Muslims. And they just said this to the Prophet Sallam, you know, claiming that people of Quraysh were inexperienced in war, and because of that they were defeated, and that Muslims must not deceive themselves thinking that they are able to defeat the Jewish of Bani Qaynuqa as well. And then he continued, or they continued, those Jewish people of Bani Qaynuqa continued, إِنَّكَ لَوْ قَاتَلْتَنَا لَعَرَفْتَ أَنَّا نَحْنُ النَّاسِ. If you fight against us, you will surely come to know that we are the people. We are the people experiencing at war. وَأَنَّكَ لَمْ تَلْقَ مِثْلَنَا. And you will know for sure and you will recognize that you have never met a people like us in a battlefield. So this was like a declaration of war against Muslims, because they said so. Prophet Muhammad ﷺ told them, please, we don't harm you, so please don't harm us. We don't attack you, so don't attack us. Please surrender to the, you know, to the law of this world. You know, at each time, you know, there is a law for the world, and if anyone breaches it, then all other people are against him because he breached the law of the world. So this is, you know, what the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ meant by saying aslimu, that surrender to the law of truth, the law of, you know, good life, you know, the law of good people, surrender, you know, to the law. And of course for Muslim, this is the law of Allah above all laws. We respect all laws, of course, but we know that Allah is the source of all good laws, of course. So Prophet Muhammad ﷺ told them, come to this law, we are applying it, you apply it as well. But they refused. And instead of saying, yes, okay, what you are saying is good, we are going to follow the, you know, like al-ma'ruf, like, you know, the good morals, you know, and the, they said, no, if you fight us, then you will know that we are the people who are experienced in war. Which means that they declared war against Muslims, and at least they told Prophet Muhammad that they are ready to fight him, and they are waiting this time to take place. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed his saying, A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem, قُلْ لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا سَتُغْلَبُونَ وَتُحْشَرُونَ إِلَى جَهَنَّمَ وَبِئْسَ الْمِهَادُ قَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ آيَةٌ فِي فِئَتَيْنِ الْتَقَتَا فِئَةٌ تُقَاتِلُ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَأُخْرَى كَافِرَةٌ يَرَوْنَهُمْ مِثْلَيْهِمْ رَأْيَ الْعَيْنِ وَاللَّهُ يُؤَيِّدُ بِنَصْرِهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَعِبْرَةً لِأُولِي الْأَبْصَارِ. Say, O Muhammad, to those disbelieving people, that you will definitely be defeated in this world if you fight us. And not only that, but وَتُحْشَرُونَ إِلَى جَهَنَّمَ وَبِئْسَ الْمَصِيرُ. And you will be gathered to Jahannam, hellfire, and it's a very, you know, evil abode. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding them of what has happened for Quraysh. قَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ آيَةٌ فِي فِئَتَيْنِ الْتَقَتَا. There was a sign for you in these two parties that met with each other, fighting against each other. فِئَةٌ تُقَاتِلُ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. One party was fighting, you know, in the name of Allah, just to prevail, you know, to defend themselves against injustice, and to defend also oppressed people as well, and to let everyone to do their best to help everyone to have his right, you know, in this life, to live an honorable life, able to decide for himself his religion, whether Islam or whatever. وَأُخْرَى كَافِرَةً. And the other party was a disbelieving party. يَرَوْنَهُمْ مِثْلَيْهِمْ رَأْيَ الْعَيْنِ. That the believing party saw by their own eyes that the disbelieving party was, you know, double their number. It was actually triple their number. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this was another, this is mentioned in another verse, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the number of the disbelievers seem to Muslims you know, yes, rather than what it was really, and just to give, you know, peace to the hearts and tranquility to the hearts of Muslims. But even if they are double their number, of course the Jewish people, they knew very well what were the number of the Quraysh people at the beginning of the war, and what were the number of the Muslims. وَاللَّهُ يُؤَيِّدُ بِنَصْرِهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. But Allah supports with His victory whoever He likes. إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَعِبْرَةً لِأُولِي الْأَبْصَارِ. Indeed, in this is a lesson for people who understand. So this is a very polite way as well. So this was another answer. So Prophet Muhammad sallam, firstly he endured their harms patiently, and he asked Muslims, don't attack them, just be patient. And then Prophet Muhammad sallam spoke to them when they continued, please don't do this, just comply with the law of goodness in this world. But they refused, and they said, if you fight us, you are, they said like this, you are very proud now, and Muslims, because you have defeated Quraysh, but Quraysh people are not good people at war. If you fight us, then we will defeat you. So, again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed these verses, and these verses also were read to them. And the verses didn't tell, you know, them any didn't, you know, give them any threat. But just the verses told that if you attack Muslims, then you will be defeated. And the proof of this is that the next verse tells them in the end, إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَعِبْرَةً لِأُولِي الْأَبْصَارِ. In this is a lesson for people who understand. So still you have time and you have chance to understand the lesson, and if you understand the lesson, then nothing bad will happen to you. We will be very happy with you, Muslims will be very happy with you, and you will be living together peacefully without any war. Still, Prophet Muhammad sallam, after this verse was revealed, or these verses, he continued asking Muslims to exercise patience, and to be patient and to be forbearing, and just to wait, and to see what time may reveal in the future. So from this we understand that Muslims don't start wars against anybody. On the contrary, when anybody likes to launch war against Muslims, they try to avoid war as much as they can. They only resort to war when it is the last option, then they resort to war. And this is what has happened actually. Because those Jewish people, they started to increase their aggression against Muslims. To the extent that they tried, we will know now, maybe to rape a Muslim woman, something like this. So, a Muslim woman arrived at the bazaar of the Bani Qaynuqa. She got something to sell and she sold it. And then she went to a gold smith shop and she sat there. So, this man and some of his friends at his shop, they asked her to do a very strange thing. She was covering her face. So she asked her to expose her face. And why did they do so? Just to annoy her, because they knew that she was a Muslim and she was covering her face. So they asked her to reveal and to expose her face. And this is, an aggression against her, because it's her, personal freedom to put on whatever she likes to put on, because Muslims didn't ask those Jewish people in Al-Madina to put on hijab, for example. They didn't force them to be Muslims, and they didn't ask them to put on or to dress like Muslims do. But now, those people are just doing aggression against this lady, and she is alone, and they are a group of people in the shop of one of them. So she, of course, she refused. So one of them, and he was the owner of the shop, the goldsmith, he fastened the tip or the border of her garment to her back, and she was sitting in a chair. So when she stood up, willing to leave the place, then her aura, you know, exposed. So she cried, and this is the, you know, the feeling of any Muslim lady or any lady who likes to keep her chastity. So she just, she was, of course, shocked, and she just cried very loudly, because this was a big abuse against her, and this was aggression against, you know, this Muslim citizen of Al-Madinah. So they started to laugh at her when she cried. So they didn't understand that they have done something wrong or they have committed a mistake. But they started mocking at her and laughing at her. So a Muslim man saw this. So he just attacked. We don't say he attacked the Jewish man, but he attacked the oppressor. He attacked the one who did this against this woman. He didn't attack him because he was a Jew. He attacked him because of the big mistake and crime that he has done. And again, if a crime is done by a Muslim, he will be given a punishment, the same punishment. If it is committed by any follower of any religion, then also, you know, the oppressed should be helped, regardless of his religion, and against the oppressor, regardless of the oppressor's religion as well. So the Muslim just attacked the oppressor, and this led to his death, the death of the oppressor. And he was a Jew, and he was the owner of the shop. So his people, and this was in their area, they attacked the Muslim man and they killed him as well. Which means again that this was the, like, you know, the common desire of all those people to attack Muslims. Because even, you know that you started this aggression, so, but no wise man amongst them told them that, you know, this man was wrong because he started the aggression. So now, even if, you know, when he fought, or when this Muslim fought him, this led to his death. But in the end of the day, he was the one who started the aggression. And you know, nobody knew. Maybe this, when you expose the body of a woman, what do you want to do then? Maybe they were going to rape her if this Muslim man didn't defend her. So this is a very big crime, and it is severely punished nowadays, even in many countries. So anyway, so this was their desire. They looked down at Muslims and they were very happy to attack them. And before this, they told the Prophet, the Muslims' leader, that they were ready to fight Muslims, and when this happened, the Muslims would be defeated and these things. Okay, so now also the family of the Muslim man who was killed sought help of all Muslims. So now it's, you know, the confrontation had to take place. And Prophet Muhammad Sallam now was sure that at this point of time, he Sallam became sure that there was no use of being more patient with those people. So he Sallam appointed Sayyidina Abu Lubaba ibn Abd al-Munzir. He is one of Al-Ansar, he is an Ansari from the tribe of Al-Aws. Prophet Muhammad appointed him to run the affairs of Al-Madina, and he himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, went not out of Medina's headquarters in Al-Madina, but he went with a group of Muslims in an army and led by him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to Banu Qaynuqa, to the place called Banu Qaynuqa, and to this tribe of Banu Qaynuqa. And Prophet ﷺ gave the flag of Muslims, of the army, to Sayyidina Hamza ibn Abd al-Muttalib, his uncle, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So now, from here we also can take a lesson that you need sometimes to show your power as well. Because when Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, exercised big patience and asked Muslims to do so, he was right, of course, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but also he was right when he stopped this and decided to defend Muslims. Because, sometimes, you cannot forgive all the time. If your enemy, is starting to be more violent against you because of your forgiveness, then, in this case, your enemy has left no choice for you other than defending yourself by power, by force. And this exactly what has happened with Muslims. Okay, so when Prophet, when they came to know that Prophet Muhammad ﷺ was coming to them, what did they do? And they were the most brave amongst their people at Al-Madinah at that time. And they used to have a lot of weapons in their homes, and they were working in blacksmithing and goldsmithing and these things. But they didn't do anything other than hiding in their forts. And Prophet Muhammad sallam sieged them for 15 days, and he couldn't come out of their forts. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cast fear in their hearts, so they were not able to confront Muslims in a battlefield. And subhanallah, al-jaza' min jins al-amal, like when someone is kind, or like Prophet ﷺ says, الرحمون يرحمهم الله تعالى, when someone is merciful to people, then Allah shows him mercy all the time. And when someone does not show mercy to people and show violence against people for no valid reason, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, humiliates him. And they said to Muslims and to the Prophet ﷺ, we are the people who are experienced in war, and if you meet us, you will be definitely defeated. And then, when the time came for meeting against Muslims in a battlefield, they just kept hiding in their forts. And the reason for this, many reasons, but just, Al-Jazam, just Al-Amad is one thing. And the other thing, of course, is that Al-Nasr min indillah, the victory is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So those people were against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because they were attacking others unjustly. And Prophet Muhammad sallam, of course, he is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even if a non-Muslim, even if a fair non-Muslim, not judging the Prophet because he's a Muslim, but just because of his attitude, that he didn't attack them, and then he exercised patience, and he tried not to fight against them. So this person, this kindness, is always also supported by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And before this, of course, Prophet Muhammad sallam and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the messenger of Allah, and alhamdulillah, following, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, believing in the oneness of Allah, and calling to it. So, also, Prophet Muhammad sallam told in one hadith that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him certain privileges. And one of them was, وَنُصِرْتُ بِالرُّعْبِ مَسِيرَةَ شَهْرٍ, that Allah supported me with putting, fear in the hearts of my enemies, even for 1 month before I arrived their place. So subhanAllah. So yes, because those people were very powerful people, and Al-Madina is their place. Prophet Muhammad is a newcomer. Now, like about 2 years only now for the Prophet living in Medina, but they
were there and their grandfathers, and but they just kept hiding in their forts. And also it shows something more, that when you know that you are doing right, then this gives you power. When someone knows that he is doing wrong, then this gives him weakness. So this also, this happens all the time, during all different ages. Okay, so the outcome of this, of this fear of the those Banu Qaynuqa, is that after 15 days, all their food finished, and they didn't find any solution other than going out their forts. But even when they did so, they didn't like to fight. So they sent to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they said, told him, we will accept your judgment. You just give a judgment and tell what should be done with us, and we're going to accept this. So subhanAllah, this complete, you know, defeat. They didn't even fight. They didn't even try to fight. And when you tell your enemy something like this, it means that, you know that you expect the worst, and you accept this because you are frightened. And also jazaa min jinsi al-amal, because they used to frighten Muslim ladies as well. So they used to frighten them. You see, you remember what they did with this lady. She was alone in their place, and this was their area of Jewish people. Not a big number of Muslims go there, only like a few Muslims who go just to buy something or to sell something. So they took this chance to annoy any comer to them from the Muslim side, which is very bad, and they did so against a woman, which is even worse. And they used to frighten women, Muslim women like this. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them the same and even bigger, you know. And subhanAllah, so they told Prophet ﷺ, we are accepting your judgment on our lives, on our wealth, on our women, and on our children. So alhamdulillah, this is the nasr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they were tied behind their backs when they were brought out of this fort, of their forts. Of course, just to make sure that it is not a lie. Okay. So subhanAllah, this was a very bad defeat for them. But what has happened? This is another story. I'm not going to be long today, inshallah, or tonight. But this is another story. You know that we have come to know that after the Ghazwa Badr, the hypocrites started to appear in Al-Madina. You know, hypocrites were either originally disbelievers, like polytheists, or some of the Jewish as well, who didn't like, of course, Islam, and at the same time, they were not brave enough to declare that they were against Muslims, and they had extreme love for this dunya, so they liked to get some gains of this dunya as well. So they declared their Islam falsely, and they were not true Muslims, just to get gains, because they thought Muslims now are powerful people, so we will just declare by our tongue that we are with them, so that we are giving them, if they have any more wealth, more money, and more good future, better future, then we are with them. So their head was Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salim. So now, he did his best, to save those Jewish people of Banu Qaynuqa. But he didn't do this by fighting against Muslims, because now, in front of everybody in Medina, he is a Muslim. So what he did, he started his hypocritical role, and began to ask Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم persistently to forgive them. It was very strange. And he justified this by saying that they were the allies of his tribe from Al-Khazraj. And because of that, Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, he was telling Prophet Muhammad ﷺ that Prophet ﷺ had to just forgive them. Because they, for a long time ago, they were the allies of Al-Khazraj, the allies of his tribe. And you know, subhanAllah, the way the hypocrites behave exposes them. Because it couldn't be that a Muslim can never, you know, ask a request from the Prophet ﷺ like this. You know, you see they threatened the Prophet and told him, we will defeat you. And they tried to kill the Prophet ﷺ. And then they exposed the awra of a Muslim woman and they threatened Muslim women. So how come that you ask, you know, Prophet Muhammad ﷺ to forgive them? So then, you know, hypocrites all the time, the way they behave exposes them. So this is the first thing. And like in the Holy Quran, يخادعون الله والذين آمنوا وما يخدعون إلا أنفسهم وما يشعرون. They try to deceive Allah and the believers. وما يخدعون إلا, but they only deceive themselves. But they do not know, they do not feel it. So, you know, so Abdullah ibn Umar said, well, now he was exposing himself in front of all Muslims to know that he is a hypocrite. But of course, no one could pass this judgment because this is something inside the heart, and we are Muslims, we are not allowed to judge people because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the judge. So we cannot judge anybody unless we see, you know, a very clear, tangible proof. And even this not by ordinary Muslim, by the judge and so on. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam just kept silent because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew that this man was a hypocrite. But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't like to expose this to the other members of the, you know, big or large community or even the Muslim community in Al-Madinah. Because Prophet ﷺ didn't like, as he said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in one occasion, أتريدون يعني يعني أن يظن الناس أن محمدا يقتل أصحابه أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. Prophet ﷺ, in one occasion, he said to someone of the companions who asked him to kill a hypocrite. So Prophet ﷺ told him, I'm not going to do so because if I do so, then the disbelievers, the polytheists, will spread a rumor saying that Muhammad kills Muslims, Muhammad kills his companions. So they will frighten people, you know, from accepting Islam, telling them that if you become Muslim, then you don't guarantee. Maybe you become Muslim like Abdullah ibn Salul, and then Muhammad kills you and you are Muslim. So don't go to Muhammad. If you go to, now we are saving you, we are protecting you. But if you declare you are Muslim, and then you go to the Muslims, and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gets hold of you, then he may kill you, like what he has done with Abdullah ibn Salul. So this was the reason why Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't kill the hypocrites. Because, and this shows that Muslims, you know, should be understanding the world around them. Some people, you know, something you may think, yes, this is the proper thing to be done. Yes, this is the proper thing to be done. But if you do it now, it will lead to a bigger harm, you know, and it may lead to, you know, a dilemma, you know, a big problem. It may destroy the whole thing. So you don't do it. Yeah, you know that it's a proper thing, but you don't do it. So Prophet Muhammad didn't like to answer him because he didn't like to tell him you are a hypocrite, and also he didn't like to forgive those people, and he knew sallallahu their danger. And alhamdulillah, this is ni'mah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala supported him and supported Muslims, and they could overcome them. So how come that after Allah giving them this ni'mah, just say to them, okay, now you go, you are free. And they were people who didn't keep their covenant for the first time. So those people, especially those people, you know, they were not people who would keep their any other covenant in future. So how come the Prophet ﷺ would forgive them? And so Prophet ﷺ just kept silent. So Abdullah ibn Salul repeated his request again. So Prophet ﷺ also kept silent. Then Abdullah ibn Salul took hold of Prophet Muhammad ﷺ from the container of his armor. And like he pulled him something like this. So Prophet Muhammad ﷺ told him, "Arsilni, release me." And Prophet Muhammad ﷺ got angry, and his color changed. ﷺ, because this was done against him. But he continued, you know, holding Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. So Prophet Muhammad ﷺ said to him another time, "Why, Huka, arsilni? Like, what is wrong with you? Release me." So Abdullah ibn Abi Salul, and this is the difference between a Muslim and a hypocrite. A Muslim can never do this for the Prophet ﷺ. Can never. This is not imaginable. So all Muslims, they knew that this person, this is a hypocrite, but no one could kill him or cause him any harm, because Prophet ﷺ didn't declare this, didn't say it clearly that this is a hypocrite, and didn't give permission to anyone to kill him or to harm him. And so Abdullah ibn Salul, he was holding Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. Prophet Muhammad ﷺ telling him, "What is wrong with you? Release me." Prophet Muhammad ﷺ was able to hit him, of course. Prophet Muhammad ﷺ was the most brave man in the battlefield. In any battlefield, he was the nearest to the enemy. The companions used to, you know, in the most difficult and hard time of war, they used to seek protection, with Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, you know, or by Prophet Muhammad ﷺ in the battlefield. So Prophet ﷺ was very able, very easily, just to hit him. But he didn't do this even. And he was the leader. And Abdullah ibn Salul told him, "Wallahi," taking an oath by Allah, and he is an unbeliever, "Wallahi la ursiluka hatta tuhsina fi mawali." By Allah, I will never release you until you do good, or you show kindness to my allies. 400 حاسر و300 دارع قد منعوني من الأحمر والأسود تحصدهم في غداة واحدة. Said there are 400 men, with no arms, and 300 men with arms. They used to protect me against all different peoples of different colors, red and black people. تحصدهم في غدا, are you going to kill them all, you know, in one morning, or, you know, to harm them all in one morning, to get rid of them all in one morning? إني والله امرء أخشى الدوائر. By Allah, I am a man who fears, you know, the future, who thinks in his future, time to come. And no, I cannot live like this. Those people used to protect me, and I need to keep them. So of course, this cannot be said by a Muslim. Because he's speaking like he's not a Muslim. He's speaking like he's not a Muslim. And he's speaking like, you know, قَدْ مَنَعُونِ, like he is a big leader. Still, he's a big leader of Medina. Because he was, as you know, he was about to be declared as the king for Medina, or of Medina, just before Prophet's Hijrah to Al-Madina. So this is his language, you know. Now he's speaking like the president or the king of Medina, not like a follower of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But again, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't cause him any harm. On the contrary, Prophet Muhammad ﷺ accepted, and he responded to his request. As the books of Sirah say, فَوَهَبَهُمْ لَهُ. فَوَهَبَهُمْ لَهُ, وَهَبَ means hiba, like a gift. فَوَهَبَهُمْ لَهُ, it means like It is as if Prophet Muhammad sallam gave all these 700 people as a gift to him, just for Abdullah ibn Salam to be happy. And of course, not for him to be happy, but to prevent the fitna. So to prevent the fitna by, you know, forgiving 700 men who were very keen to kill the Prophet and to kill all Muslims and to take them out of Al-Madinah. But you know, وَالْفِتْنَةُ أَكْبَرُ مِنَ الْقَتْلِ. And another verse, وَالْفِتْنَةُ أَشَدُّ مِنَ الْقَتْلِ. Because, you know, even if those people are going in future to kill some Muslims, fitna is worse than this. Because fitna means that everything will be collapsed. You know, if now, because Abdullah ibn Salul is a Muslim in front of everybody, and, you know, if Prophet Muhammad sallam, Abdullah ibn Salul is trying to create this fitna as well. So now Muslims will be divided, you know, and Muslims will be fighting against each other. And when Muslims fight each other, then, khalas, then they cannot, of course, fight their enemies, and gradually, step by step, they will be scattered everywhere in the world, having no world at all in the world, attacked by everybody, every day and every night, and that's it, and finish. And they don't have time, of course, to, you know, to tell people about the true guidance of Allah, and they have not even enough time for themselves to worship Allah. So religion, you know, is threatened. Allah is keeping his religion, but I mean practically, religion is not life on this earth. So Prophet ﷺ knew all these things. So فَوَهَبَهُمْ لَهُ. He gifted him all these 700 people just for him to keep silent, not to cause this fitna. And if this is amazed, you know, it is astonishing more than this. You know, when you ponder over Muslims now, Muslims, this army, you know, imagine Prophet ﷺ had an army with him who sieged these forts and those people for 15 days and nights. And all of them, they accepted the decision of their leader. And the decision was, forget about all, you know, the efforts you have done. Now, it is as if you had not gone away your homes. It is like, you know, you didn't do anything. Now those people, you know. So, subhanAllah, but this shows to what extent the companions also, two things they, or let's say three things, they love Prophet Muhammad so much, they understood their duty towards Prophet Muhammad and just, you know, that to obey him, whatever the case is, and also, they understood, you know, what's going around them. Because no one of them asked Prophet ﷺ, why did you do so? It was very clear to them. They knew, they understood that this man is a hypocrite. He has some people who are ready to support him. A bigger problem is going to start. We don't need this now or at any other time. So, of course, Prophet ﷺ, you know, has to be followed. So they were also aware of what's going on. Okay, but Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I will conclude by this. Subhanallah, you know, al-jazaa' al-jism amal as well. You know, this forbearing of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and of the Muslims were not, you know, to go for nothing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, alhamdulillah, of course, it is so generous. So what happened to those Banu Qaynuqa? Prophet Muhammad just said one thing. He said, okay, I will forgive them, but let them go somewhere else outside Medina to stay. Because now, you know, it's very difficult for them to stay after a war has started between them and some other parties of the Medina community. Then they cannot live in the same place, and they didn't show any regret for what they have done. They didn't show any readiness to go into another covenant with Muslims. So Prophet ﷺ just asked you know, told Abdullah ibn Umayyah Salul, yes, but, you know, they have to go somewhere else, just outside Medina to stay there. So they actually went to a place in Syria. They went to Syria. They went to a place called Azra'at, which is now Daraa. So they went there and they stayed there. So the books of Sira said, or say, فَقَلَّ أَنْ لَبِثُوا فِيهَا حَتَّى هَلَكَ أَكْثَرُهُمْ. So they stayed, you know, for a short period there, and you know, and they were all, you know, they all, you know, died, subhanAllah. Or many of them, most of them, the majority of them, after staying a short period there, in that place, you know, they died. Maybe by a plague or any disease or anything, but subhanAllah, jazaa min jinsi al-amal. Because now the two al-husnayayn, you know, the two good things has happened. Prophet Muhammad could get rid of them. And this, you know, subhanAllah, the support of Allah, they died, they just died. And at the same time, Prophet Muhammad, alhamdulillah, could prevent the fitna. So this is the jaza of when someone does something just for sake of Allah. Because when Prophet Muhammad forgave them, he didn't know that they are going to die. But he did this only for sake of Allah. So when a Muslim does anything for sake of Allah, even if he cannot see the good consequence by his own eyes, but he should be sure that because he's doing this for sake of Allah, then the good consequence is there, will come one day, definitely. And the last thing is that, just, you know, to ponder over something as well, that this is the first war to take place between Muslims and a Jewish community. And the reason of this war was that they tried to expose a Muslim lady. So subhanAllah, you know, in this world, some people, they try to be modest, to keep their chastity, and this is their personal freedom, and they do not attack customs or traditions of others. They do not tell anyone who is not, you know, even who is, you know, anyway, who is dressing in any certain other manner, other than theirs. They do not tell him, no, you have to follow our way of dressing. But despite of this, they are, through different points of time, and through different ages, sometimes, somewhere, they are attacked by others and given false accusations. So subhanAllah, this is the nature of people. And of course, a Muslim, he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the time to give him true guidance, to guide him to all good things, and also to guide and all other people all over the world for all good things as well, and to let good intentions, inshallah, spread in this world, and that people don't fight for this very, it's a very minor thing. I mean, yes, it's a big, because they did this aggression. But what is the point? Why you expose a Muslim woman? So this led to your death now. So why you did so? So sometimes some human beings, they don't understand that, you know, they may do something which is great in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, this was great. This led to the, the end of Bani Qaynuqa. No Bani Qaynuqa anymore. And what they did this thing. So subhanAllah, human beings, and also ourselves, because this can apply to any other sin as well. So we don't think that you're doing a small sin is something easy. It could be in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala something very dangerous, and it could lead to something bad. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all, inshaAllah. Allahumma laka alhamdu kama yanbaghi li jalali wajhika wa azim sultanik. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد في الأولين، وصل على سيدنا محمد في الآخرين، وصل على سيدنا محمد في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين. اللهم نسألك الجنة وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل، ونعوذ بك من النار وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل. اللهم نسألك العفو والعافية وحسن الخاتمة. اللهم نسألك العفو والعافية والمعافاة. في الدين والدنيا والآخرة. اللهم أصلح لنا ديننا الذي هو عصمة أمرنا، وأصلح لنا دنيانا التي فيها معاشنا، وأصلح لنا آخرتنا التي إليها معادنا، واجعل الحياة زيادة لنا في كل خير، واجعل الموت راحة لنا من كل شر. اللهم أنت ربنا لا إله إلا أنت، خلقتنا ونحن عبيدك، ونحن على عهدك ووعدك ما استطعنا. نعوذ بك من شر ما صنعنا، نبوء لك بنعمتك علينا ونبوء بذنوبنا. فاغفر لنا فاغفر لنا فاغفر لنا، فإنه لا يغفر الذنوب إلا أنت. اللهم بارك لنا فيما بقي من شعبان، اللهم بارك لنا فيما بقي من شعبان، واجعلنا ممن غفرت لهم فيه يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم بلغنا رمضان، اللهم بلغنا رمضان، اللهم وفقنا لصيامه وقيامه إيمانا بك واحتسابا. اللهم خذ بأيدينا ونواصينا إليك أخذ الأحبة الكرام عليك. هب لنا من لدنك أعمالا صالحة تقربنا إليك برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين، وارحم أمواتنا أجمعين. اللهم احفظنا واحفظ أبناءنا وبناتنا وأزواجنا في هذه البلاد. اللهم احفظ المسلمين أجمعين من بين أيديهم ومن خلفهم وعن أيمانهم وعن شمائلهم ومن فوقهم، ونعوذ بعظمتك أن نغتال من تحتنا. اللهم استر عوراتنا وآمن روعاتنا. اللهم احفظ شبابنا ونساءنا وشيوخنا وأطفالنا. اللهم إن أردت فتنة بخلقك فنجنا إليك غير مفتونين. اللهم اهدنا لما اختلف فيه من الحق بإذنك. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه، وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا، وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. رب اغفر لي ولوالدي وللمؤمنين يوم يقوم الحساب. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين، واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك، أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت، أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. جزاكم الله خير، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليماً.